Hello everyone, this is Mamta Sharma from IHR Support Foundation and we welcome you to this 12th episode of True Talks, a special interview series where we answer questions related to various themes to reach a deeper understanding of self and life. To answer our questions, we have with us Nitin Shah, founder and director of IHR and IHR Support Foundation. Welcome, Nitin.
Thank you, Mamta. How are you?
I am good. And welcome everyone to this episode of True Talks, in which we are going to talk about weight management from body to mind. If you have any questions or suggestions, please leave them in the comments below and we'll answer them as we go. You can also start a watch party wherever you're watching this video so that your friends and connections can also benefit from this discussion. So Nitin, today we are going to talk about weight and mind. And we've been talking about how unconscious processes are controlled by the unconscious mind. So will it be fair to say that the body processes related to weight, like digestion, metabolism, are also controlled by the mind?
Yes, the unconscious mind.
Okay. So would it be also right to say that weight issues are primarily related to our mind and the mental state?
Well, the mental state influences your weight to a large extent, a lot more than what we really understand, both directly and indirectly.
Okay. So would that mean that working with the mind would be enough and we don't really need to care about what we eat or whether we exercise or not?
Well, okay. So I wouldn't say that you don't have to care about any of that because all of them are important. Right. But you have to look at it this way, that while dieting, maintaining a healthier lifestyle and also going for exercises and yoga is very important. But aren't there places where people have actually paid for yoga, paid for exercises? They have actually gone to the dietitian and they've also taken their diet plan and yet they are not able to eat it?
Yes.
Now, wouldn't it be fair to say that they are not able to maintain their diet or they are not able to regularly go for an exercise because their mental state stops them from doing so?
You can say that. Most people would say that they just don't feel like going to the gym or they don't want to eat the food that is prescribed by the dietitian.
Correct. And then some people would say that the that junk food looks very tasty and very exciting. Gym, we get tired thinking about gym. So aren't these mental states that we spoke about? Mental and physical states that we spoke about?
Right.
And what did we discuss earlier when we have to manage our mental states? What do we do?
We need to manage our thoughts and emotions.
Correct. So which takes us back to working with our mind, working with our unconscious.
Correct. Right.
So that's an indirect way in which the mind influences our health, our weight, by ensuring whether we are able to do or not able to do the things that need to be done.
Right. That makes sense. Right? Yes. You also said that mind, you know, last when we were talking about the mind and body connection, you said that the mind can influence processes being run by the body. So are you saying that we can work with the mind to influence or regulate our metabolism, digestion, and all these processes that are related to weight?
To a large extent, yes, you can. See, you have to understand it this way. If your digestion is not the way it needs to be, because it's a health issue, then you need to work with health conditions.
Correct.
Right? Whatever is the underlying health issue that is stopping the digestion from performing the way it needs to.
Right.
And we have already discussed during the health episode how our mind can play a very, very important complementary role to medical treatment when it comes to improving our health.
Correct.
Right. Apart from that, we can also use a lot of suggestions, metaphors to be able to increase or decrease our metabolism rate. And obviously, there are other processes that we may need to use if there are deeper emotional issues that are involved.
Okay. So, can you kind of explain this a bit?
All right. So, when we talk about weight, what are the possible deeper issues that the mind can play a role with, right? So notice we spoke about positive intention, I think, in the health episode.
That something that happening in the body may be serving a purpose for the unconscious mind.
Precisely. So now when we talk about weight, and if our body is not willing to let go of the weight, then maybe is there a possibility that it's serving some intention, some purpose, that the mind is getting something in return?
Right. Correct.
So now when we talk about this, that's actually one of the places where only suggestions will not be enough, because suggestions for creating a change in behavior will work when there is no positive intention involved. But if there's a positive intention involved, then we also need to be able to address that positive intention.
Okay. So can you give us an example of, you know, positive intention with respect to weight?
So with respect to weight, there are three places that I can see where positive intention can play a role. One is with specific behaviors.
Okay.
Second is with the actual idea of weight, whether I'm losing or not losing weight. And third is with respect to my appearance. And let me give you an example for each of them so that it becomes a bit more clear.
Yes.
Right? So when we speak about behavior, I have to cut down on sweets, right? To be able to manage my weight.
Yes.
That will be one of the things that I need to do.
Yeah. A lot of people, yes.
But there are so many people who have this association between sweets and feeling love. Right?
Yep.
So whenever they feel that they are alone, or whenever they feel that they are feeling unloved, then they have a natural tendency to eat sweets.
Right.
Now, would we be able to change that behavior completely if we are not able to address the underlying need for love?
Not really. We may try to kind of fight with ourselves for a day or two, but I'm sure we'll come back
to it. And when it comes to a situation where you're feeling unloved, in that moment the sweets are kept in front of you. Then it's like really difficult.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. I remember they have shown this in like various movies and shows where, you know, a person is very sad and they suddenly sit down with a tub of ice cream and, you know, kind of start eating.
In fact, if you've seen the recent movie, Dil Dhadakne Do.
Yes, I remember.
There's a scene in that movie where Sefali Chaya goes and starts eating a cake. Like, she literally starts gulping down a cake after she feels she has been mistreated by Anil Kapoor.
Yes, I remember, yes.
That scene is like an apt scene to describe how food can make us feel loved or happy, and how we are using food to at times be able to deal with deeper voids. And that's the positive intention that we are talking about right now.
Yes, correct.
Right?
Makes sense.
Now, that's one example. And similar to this, there are times when people would tell you, right, that when we are home, when there is nothing else to do, we are doing time pass eating.
Oh, yes. So many people. In fact, I think right now it's currently happening. It's like a phenomena, right?
Correct. So right now, a lot of people are just cooking and eating. It's good that their cooking skills are improving, but then that food is still going in their stomach. And a lot of them are doing it not because they're eating, just because there's nothing else to do that they have.
Right. Makes sense.
Right? So that's the first part of it, that there is a positive intention with respect to our behavior directly. And again, waking up in the morning, going to the gym, we don't feel like going to the gym because our sleep has not been taken care of completely. So that will be another example. That my body needs more sleep and therefore it's not letting me wake up, which is again a specific behavior. Right? Now, apart from the specific behavior, weight can also play a role. Positive intention can also play a role when it comes to the actual weight. There are certain people that you'll come across who would tell you that I'm not even doing what I need to do to manage my weight. I'm not exercising, I'm not dieting, and so on.
Correct.
Right? There I understand that they are putting on weight because the logical things that they need to do, they still are not doing it. But you'll come across certain people who will tell you that I'm doing everything that I can. In fact, my dietitian, my gym instructor is telling me, I have no idea what else can I make you do. Probably I can't do as much as you are doing right now. And yet the weight is not coming under control.
Hmm.
So wouldn't it be fair to say that in spite of us doing everything we can to be able to manage the weight, and logically it should work, for some reason the mind is just not willing to let go of that weight? So if the mind is holding on to that weight, then probably there is some positive intention associated to it.
Yes, of course.
Right? So to give you an example, I had a client some time back, and we were working, she had a slightly different problem, but kind of on the same lines, where she said that when I start working with reducing my weight, I'm able to succeed in it. But then I give up for some reason. That I feel it's too much of a work, and then I give up. And then I give up, I put on weight again. Once again, when it reaches like a health scar, then I start exercising again. I reduce my weight again, and then something happens and I don't feel like doing it. And then I pick up the weight again. So basically, she's having a relapse in terms of weight gain over and over again.
Right. I think it happens with a lot of people. I mean, the reasons could be different, but then yes, they keep gaining and losing.
Correct. So while we were having a discussion, while we were having a conversation, I actually asked her a few questions, and then she mentioned something which was very interesting, which I don't think I would have been able to figure out if she wouldn't have given me those answers. And she said that, interestingly, while having a conversation with you, I'm realizing that when I am overweight, everyone around me comes and tells me, you need to start doing something about your weight.
Okay.
I feel really bad about it. But I also feel people care. And when I start reducing weight, initially people do come and give me a lot of attention and tell me, Kecha, you're looking pretty, you're looking good, you've started working out, we are proud of you. But over a period of time, no one comes and keeps coming and telling you, oh, you're still exercising, it's so good that you're still exercising. After a few weeks, it becomes like a normal day-to-day activity, and no one really compliments her for that then. And she says, and then all of a sudden start feeling no one is paying attention, no one cares. And that's one of the reasons why I kind of get disappointed, and then I feel, what is the point of doing all of this if no one cares? So for her, having that weight with people constantly telling her, do something about it, itself became a source of attention. And because for her, that sense of care, the sense of attention is important. The moment she feels that I'm not getting that attention because my system is letting off weight, the system immediately puts on. Right? And the idea of relapse with weight is so constant and so common. I'm sure you would know of people around you who actually have had those issues.
Yeah, I said that they're in a constant cycle of lose some, gain some, lose some, gain some. You know, they keep going through that.
Perfect. And partially, we actually also spoke about this during the goal setting process when we spoke about motivation. Remember that when the motivation is high, but if the disappointment is higher, then we tend to delay whatever we are doing. So that not being able to fulfill our positive intention is also a source of disappointment.
Correct. Right?
And then third is the way you look.
Okay.
Now, so again, this is based on a case that I ran this sometime back where the client consciously wanted to let go of her weight and she wanted to reduce it. She said that I'm doing everything that I can, but something just doesn't seem to click. And I don't know, it's almost as if my body wants to hold on to this. And then when we started speaking more and when we did a couple of processes, what came out was that when she was a child, there was an incident where there was something happened where someone tried to take advantage of her. And in her head, she told herself that because I'm pretty, this has happened to me.
Okay.
And if I have to be safe, then I should not be pretty. And because for a lot of people, it gets associated to how pretty you look or how good you look. Our system started on weight as a means to keep her feel safe. So now that feeling of again becomes
positive intention. Yeah, makes sense.
And since these positive intentions are at the level of unconscious, people consciously don't remember it, because in all the cases that I've mentioned right now, most people actually don't remember consciously what their positive intentions are. You can sit with them, have a conversation with them, and probably after a few hours or a few weeks of observing, or maybe at times even a few months of observation, they figure out what the unconscious positive intention is. But it's just a lot more faster to connect with unconscious and work with the unconscious to understand what the positive intention is.
Yeah, perfect. That makes perfect sense. And Nitin, while we are talking about weight and mind, can we also talk about, you know, specific strategies or techniques like we have been doing in previous episodes to work with the mind to resolve the weight issue? You know, like, is there like a handbook or a manual that one can refer to for oneself?
So I'm going to talk about specific tips that you can follow as far as mind is concerned, which is able to work with your weight. But I'm kind of first clarifying all the things that you need to understand, because then those strategies will become more effective. You'll understand why those strategies are working.
Okay. Okay. And since, because we've been talking about positive intention, I've also noticed that, for a lot of people, it is more about emotional eating. You know, they're trying to fulfill like a deeper need to eat, like to fill something up. And so is this also the reason that why we do that? You know, some of us do emotional eating.
Well, emotional eating is by definition because we are having emotions, right? Then that is something that you need to work with your mind. And the fact that you're doing emotional eating is because that food is making you feel emotionally something better.
Correct.
So by definition, it becomes something that is driven by positive intention.
So they're kind of trying to fill some emptiness, so to say, within them.
Right.
That makes sense. So then, because that may also be, a lot of people may not be aware that, you know, there's a like an emptiness or an unconscious emptiness, let's say. That also needs to be addressed at the level of the unconscious, right?
Correct. So a lot of times our food habits are driven by certain voids that we are trying to fulfill. Again, when I spoke about eating for pastime, that's an example of void, right? And in such cases, we need to be able to work with the unconscious to be able to manage that way. And I am going to talk about specific things that we can do with the unconscious for that in some time.
Okay. And while we are talking about managing weight, and a lot of people struggle with losing weight, there are also another set of people who struggle to gain weight, you know. So do the same principles apply, or is it something else?
Yeah, generally the same principles apply. Obviously, the positive intentions may vary from people to people. In fact, positive intention even for weight gain or not being able to lose weight will vary from people to people, right? But the basic ideology remains the same.
Okay. And right. So what would be that difference? Like, is there a difference, in terms of, like, I understand them at one set of people have a slower metabolism and one set of people have probably a better metabolism. So what would it be like in terms of mental state or something?
So apart from the positive intention bit that we have spoken about, right? The key difference will be about metabolism rate. And that is something that a lot of people talk about. In fact, I've had so many people coming and telling me that, Nitin, I'm not able to lose weight because my metabolism rate is low. And there are some people who come and say that I'm not able to gain weight because my metabolism rate is low. My metabolism rate is very high. Right? And interestingly, there are people who literally tell you that even when I start eating less, my metabolism rate also drops with the amount of food that I'm eating.
Correct.
So it's not that my metabolism rate is low and it's consistently low. When I start eating less, the metabolism rate at times becomes very low. I've had friends coming and telling me that even when I drink a glass of water, I feel as if my stomach is bloating.
Yes. A lot of overweight people complain. Ki hume to hawa pani bhi lag jata hai, you know, that kind of a thought.
Correct. So that idea that even breathing or drinking water makes me bloat is one a belief that obviously needs to be worked upon. And second also is the fact that that's an indicator that it's not that their metabolism rate is just low. It's also that it further drops if they're eating less.
Yes.
Right. And interestingly, again, from a therapy point of view, we had a client some time back where this was someone who wanted to gain weight and was not able to gain.
Okay.
Okay. And only suggestions are not working. So we had to try certain advanced processes. What came out was really interesting.
Okay.
That while the child was in the mother's womb during pregnancy, the mother was in a fight mode where she had certain challenges in her life and she was trying to fight everything that came her way. In terms of the fight-flight response. And the child's metabolism kind of picked it up and it became like, throw whatever you want to throw at me and I'll digest it, I'll take care of it. So it's like working overtime. Right?
Okay.
And interestingly, the reverse also many a times is true, where when the mother is in a flight mode during the pregnancy, there's a possibility that the child's metabolism actually become slower. Because the metabolism is also on a flight mode. It's like, I don't want to do it. I don't want to face this right now.
Makes sense.
And that, and that's the reason why there's so much of emphasis on on taking care of the mother's mental health during pregnancy. That she needs to be in a happier state, that she needs to be surrounded by people who take care of her. She needs to listen to nice music. Right? So all of that is because the mother's mental health at the time of delivery or during pregnancy actually has a possibility to affect the child. We have spoken about obviously the child's weight right now and metabolism rate, but otherwise also.
Right. It's interesting that you speak about that, Nitin, because last year I helped. So I was consulting on an assignment for the Ministry of Health and we published a book which is called The Journey of the 1,000 Days, in which we explained in great detail what all a mother and the rest of the family should do right from the time the child is conceived. Not only because so far, most of our focus has been on the fetus or the newborn's physical health. You know, most of us are concerned about gora hai ya nahi, lamba hai ya nahi, healthy hai ya nahi. It's very rarely that people care about mental health right from that age, you know, from the fetal age. So it's very interesting that you talk about, you know, the implications of mother's mental state on the unborn child's mental state and how it can, you know, carry on later in life.
Yeah, and I really think that that's something that is, that should be a major area of focus as far as mental health is concerned.
Yeah, and if anyone is interested, you can look it up on the Ministry of Health's website. It's called The Journey of the 1,000 Days. And now that we are talking about this, Nitin, are we also
Just before you say that, Mamta, I'm so happy knowing this, that the government has taken an initiative, something like this, because that kind of indicates that they are at least paying attention to mental health.
From that level itself.
Correct.
So, which actually makes sense, because traditionally, you know, like, I think we were discussing it once, you and me, that how, you know, garbh sanskar and how it was important for the mother to read good literature and listen to good things. And I think this was the underlying idea. We probably lost it somewhere along the way, but maybe we need to go back to it.
Yeah, so I think that's okay. Sooner or later, we should get back there.
Okay. And now that we are discussing it, are we also doing an episode on parenting in True Talks?
So we have not actually scheduled it. That's one topic that we somehow missed out on. I think probably we will add that in one of the episodes. We'll do a complete episode on that, if I'm not wrong.
Brilliant, brilliant. So coming back to weight now. We have talked about, you know, how people struggle with too much weight, too little weight, emotional eating. There are also people who suffer from, you know, eating disorders, bulimia, anorexia. So can you shed some light on that as well, please?
So bulimia is basically where people, when they eat, they have a tendency to eat a lot. But once they've eaten, then they feel guilty and then they end up puking. They would actually induce artificial vomit and then they will vomit out everything that they've eaten. Right? And in most cases, when you work with them, again, everything that I'm saying is based on most cases. They don't blindly apply it to every case. because individual cases may vary, but this still is an indicator to help you understand that while cases vary from one to another, there is an underlying emotional component to a lot of things related to eating. So with bulimia, a couple of things that's seen is that people who, when if they're eating a lot, they're eating a lot because of two reasons. One, that there's this sense of emptiness that they're trying to fill up, right? The void that we spoke about. And second, that you know how we have this sensations in our stomach, which tell us that you've eaten a lot. It's time for you to stop.
Right, right.
For some people, those signals are not working. And because of that, they don't realize when to stop. And they vomit because later when they realize they've eaten a lot, they feel guilty. Or because, for example, some of them may be models and so on, and they start feeling that maybe it'll affect my career. So that fear or that guilt then makes them take the next action of making an attempt to vomit whatever they've eaten.
So, the tips and the strategies that you said you were going to later tell us about, can that those be used to work on eating disorder or resolve eating disorders?
So, see, as I mentioned earlier, anything that gets categorized in the category of disorder and has deeper emotional issues associated to it, it's always better to go to a therapist. And if you ask me, well, I can't claim for every therapist, but if you're especially seeking or visiting a cognitive hypnotic psychotherapist, then you will be better off because they have been trained to handle all the things that we've spoken about in all the videos and that we'll speak about going forward.
Right.
But some of the tips that I'm going to talk about today will be complementary. So while you're visiting your therapist and the therapist is working with you, you will also be able to use those tips with yourself, which will only aid the therapist's work.
Okay. And now that you're telling me, I'm curious. So what would the therapist do in these processes? What would happen?
So when I'm talking about the tips, I'll share the tips first. And then I'll tell you that if the tips don't work, then when do you need to go to a therapist? And what do you expect from the therapist after that?
Okay. And you spoke about bulimia. What about anorexia? Like, do we need to go to the therapist or can we do something ourselves?
Okay. So in short, you need to go to a therapist for anorexia. Anorexia has a very, very high fatality rate. So the number of deaths, the percentage of people who end up dying who have anorexia is very, very high. It's probably one of the highest in terms of percentage, right? At this moment, the reason I'm not explaining anorexia is because it will become a bit technical. And I don't think for a lot of people who will be watching this video, it will be relevant. But yeah, anorexia, if it is diagnosed earlier, and if you know the right practitioner, they should be able to assist.
So if anyone's watching, you know someone who's anorexic, so it would be better. And as Nitin said, cognitive hypnotic psychotherapists are trained to deal with such issues. Right, Nitin?
Correct. And they would obviously work with these issues in consultation with the relevant health practitioners.
Right, of course. We said that this is complementary, right? Correct. If physical medical intervention is also needed. So now that you've... can we move to solutions now? Because I'm really eagerly waiting for that. What are those tips and strategies that we can follow? And then what, like, when do we decide to go to a therapist and what do we expect from a therapist?
All right. So let me start with things that you can do at your end first. I'm going to talk about the basics first, because remember we spoke about how maintaining our healthier lifestyle and everything is also important.
Correct.
The first step to managing your weight is to identify what is your objective. Are you trying to manage your weight or are you actually trying to look better? Because they are two very different objectives and your entire line of work will vary.
Correct.
Right. So that's one bit of the story. Now, once you've identified, and I'll come to probably looks later, but if the objective is managing weight, right, then go back to the goal setting activity, make a note of the exact future that you're trying to create as a result of reducing your weight. Right. What will be the benefits? Right. How would it influence different areas of your life and all of that?
Okay. So those principles always apply whatever you're working with, whichever area of life you're working with. The success principles, the goal setting principles.
Correct. So if you're working with goals, see, eventually if you're trying to work towards something, there's a goal that you're trying to achieve, right? And when you achieve that goal, you're basically achieving success in that goal.
Correct.
So the goal setting and the success principles bit will be applied anywhere where you want to achieve something.
Correct. Makes sense.
Right. And obviously the next step then is to be able to identify what all steps do you need to take to manage your weight, exercising, dieting, going to the gym, identifying the right dietitian, being able to meditate regularly, being able to change certain aspects of your lifestyle, all of that. And then identify which of these things you're not able to do. That's the first thing, right? That we want to do all the things that we logically need to do.
Correct.
And there, if you identify that there are certain tasks that are important, but you're not able to take.
Correct.
I'm sure you know what needs to be done next.
I know. It's like memorized by heart. Manage your thoughts and emotions. Refer to that episode on True Talks.
Perfect. So if you are having certain tasks that you know are important for you to do to be able to manage your weight and you're not able to do it, then first, please go back to that episode, learn how to manage your thoughts and emotions so that you're able to execute those tasks. Now,
correct.
If you are doing all of those tasks and still the weight reduction process is taking longer than what it should, right? Then you can do a metaphor-based process to be able to manage your weight, to be able to assist you in the other things that you're doing.
Okay. Right?
Now, the metaphor process is actually quite simple. What it does is it asks you to go inside your body, create a metaphor for what's there in your stomach in terms of how would fat look like. And then you metaphorically chip off the fat from the body so that the quantity of fat reduces in your body.
Oh, so you basically visualize the whole thing within you.
Correct. Correct. So let's do one thing. Let me just run the process for you so that you and all the other people who are probably watching this video will understand what I'm saying. And this is an activity that you can do with yourself.
Perfect. Perfect. Ready.
Perfect. Right. So what I want you to do is just close your eyes. Take three slow, deep breaths. And as you take those three slow, deep breaths, I would like you to resume your normal breathing and mentally allow yourself to think of your stomach and the fat that is stored in the stomach. Right?
Okay.
Now, what I want to do is create an imagery in front of you that, in your understanding, represents how your stomach looks like with the fat inside.
Yes.
Right? Now, I want you to step inside that place where you can see the fat. And I want you to look at that fat and find a way to be able to remove or dissolve around 2% of the fat.
So just a little bit.
Just a little bit.
Okay.
Yes. Now, as you dissolve that 2% of the fat, notice a slight sense of lightness being developed in your stomach. It's almost like by that 2%, your stomach is feeling a bit lighter. Right? And then imagine that fat that you have dissolved is being discharged out of your stomach. It's being thrown out of your system.
Okay.
Okay. And then slowly bring both your hands together. Rub them, bring them closer to your eyes. Feel the warmth in your eyes and then open your eyes for coming back to the present. So what you're basically doing is chopping off, removing 2% of fat every day. And you repeat this activity for 15 days.
Oh, interesting.
Right? Obviously, this is not a replacement to your exercising and physical activity. This is going to complement it. It will just speed up the process of you being able to get the results that you're looking for.
Perfect. Makes sense. So now that you mentioned diet, how important is diet or dieting?
All right. So see, I am not a dietitian, right? So it's kind of unfair on my part to be able to comment on how important dieting is. But if I were to give you a very commonsensical kind of an answer, right? So logically, obviously, dieting is important simply because it assists you in terms of your eating habits.
Okay.
Right? Dieting, I'm not really meaning that you're going to starve yourself. That's not proper. Dieting that I'm referring to. What I'm talking about is eating healthier food, avoiding junk when possible, eating homemade food, all of that, things that your body will find easier to digest.
And how do I find out what will my body find easier to digest? Because I'm sure it will vary from person to person.
And that's where it's a good idea to go and visit a dietitian. Okay. Because obviously the dietitian is trained, they can understand your body type, they can understand the different parameters that they have based on which they create a diet plans. And then they can create a diet plan that suits you, that works best for you.
Okay. And how important is physical activity or exercise?
Well, I think that's kind of given that physical activities are extremely important. They are also important because what you're doing is you're making use of that stored energy through physical activity, which means your system is any which is converting that fat into energy. So the amount of work that your mind will have to do reduces because a part of that work is already being done because of your physical activity.
Right? Makes sense.
So what you're doing is you're kind of creating a two-way helpline where you're seeking mind health to help you deal with the positive intentions, to help you deal with the metabolism rate and so on. And you're also telling the mind that while you're helping me, I will help you in terms of managing weight by actually doing the physical activities that are required to manage the weight.
Okay. All right. So basically, both will go hand in hand. The logical things that you are needed, that you need to do. And if you are not able to do the logical steps, then you again need to manage your thoughts and emotions. And for the rest, for other places where you're not getting results, then you can do exercises like this, right? Or activities or techniques like this. And see what happens. And if still you don't see results, then probably you can go to a therapist, right?
So I think Dr. Nidhi has asked this question that will doing void management with people work when it comes to weight? Right? So doing void management is actually a good idea, especially when people are eating compulsively. So if you have been doing your tasks regularly, you have also been chipping off that additional fat away, but you are still not able to manage your eating habits. Right? Then probably a void management process is a very good process.
Okay. Can you explain what this process is? It's interesting to hear that void
management. The idea behind void management is that your body has this sense of emptiness that it's trying to fill up. Right? It's like it's like an empty spit which the system is trying to fill up by adding more and more things to it. And you will actually have people coming and telling you at times that I feel empty inside. I feel as if there is this big void that I need to clear somehow.
Which they're trying to fill with food.
So generally, let's say someone who feels unloved. Now, that lack of love is a void, right? It's a sense of emptiness. And then they're trying to fill it up with the help of food. So that's the place where void management process can be run. Let me just run that process for you because then it becomes easier for everyone to understand what the process is.
All right.
I'm doing just a variation of the process, which is a quick process, but this is again something that you should be able to do with yourself.
Perfect. Makes sense.
So what I want you to do is, Mamta, once again, close your eyes. Take 3 deep breaths again. In through your nose, out through your mouth. And after the 3 deep breaths, I want you to resume your normal breathing. But while you resume your normal breathing, I want you to imagine yourself in a room where you feel completely safe, completely comfortable. You know, it's like that safe, secure space in your mind.
Okay.
A space where you are able to connect with your unconscious.
Okay.
And as you imagine that space, and as you become more and more part of that space, you would realize there's this internal sense of feeling that you are connected to the unconscious. And as you find yourself in that space, in that room, which is completely safe, completely comfortable, I want to remind yourself of the last time when you experienced this sense of emptiness where you really wanted to eat and you really wanted to hog. And just notice where in the body do you feel that feeling, that sensation of emptiness that you wanted to fill up.
It's more like in my chest.
It's more like in your chest, right? And again, if you had to give this a color, what color would you give it?
Yellow.
Now, what I want you to do is while you are there in that room, noticing that yellow color, which represents that void, that sense of emptiness, I want you to just imagine a white light coming from the sky and covering you completely. And this white light has an intelligence of its own, and especially when it gets in touch with your body, it really understands what that void is that your system is experiencing. So as the white light begins to understand what that void is, what I want you to do is just start inhaling through your nose and exhaling through your mouth. And as you exhale, let go of that yellow color. Till you're completely free from the yellow color. Once you're able to let go of the yellow color completely, then and only then say yes and let me know.
Yes.
Correct? Now, as you let go of that color into the white light, request the white light to replace that yellow color that you've just released with something that will once and for all help you fill up that void completely, so that there is no sense of emptiness left in your system.
Okay.
Right? And once the area is completely filled, what I want you to do is just once again imagine yourself going back to that situation where you had this desire to eat. And notice if you can experience the desire somewhere again in the body, in the same part or in some other part of the body.
No, it's funny. I can still visualize the food, so I can see the image of the food, but there's no, it's not creating any urge or anything to eat or.
Brilliant. So just to test, I want you to imagine yourself in a future situation. Well, generally, you may have a tendency to feel that sense of emptiness that you felt earlier. And now let me know, as you're in that situation in future, what is the overall feeling like? Is there still some sense of emptiness? There's no sense of such emptiness.
No, nothing.
Perfect. Now, you can slowly bring both your hands together. Thank the white light for helping you in the process. And then bring the hands closer to your eyes. feel the warmth in your eyes, and then come back to the present, feeling good and fresh about yourself. Makes sense?
Makes sense. It's okay. What I released was more like a yellow smoke, but what filled in was more fluid, liquid. Is that all right?
Yeah, that's okay. Did that make you feel better?
Oh, yes.
Perfect. Yes. So that's the important bit.
Perfect. That's interesting.
Right? Now, yeah. The idea is to repeat this process every probably week till you realize that once you start thinking about those past experiences where you generally had a tendency to worry, are consistently no longer creating any feeling of void or emptiness.
Okay. 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 So while I, you know, I or anyone else does what they have to do logically, like follow the diet, some healthy food routine, exercise and all, that chipping away at the fat can be done every day.
So that chipping away of the fat is done every day for the next 50 days.
Okay. And while if you, right. And if someone feels that sense of emptiness, which makes them feel like eating or makes them eat, then they can do this exercise, the void management exercise, like once a week, right?
Correct.
Till they're able to, till that feeling's gone.
Perfect.
Oh, good. That's simple.
And with, remember with compulsive eating, I also spoke about that there is one, a possibility of void. And there is also a possibility that your system does not, is not giving you the suggestions or the indications that it's full. Right. So for that and for increasing metabolism, at times simply giving positive suggestions can be good enough. So just before you go off to sleep, a suggestion like, I would like my unconscious to be able to give me the right signals when my stomach is full every day, so that I know it's time for me to stop eating.
Okay. Okay.
And good suggestions. That suggestions. So again, it's like when then, right? That when I've had as much as I need to have, then my mind is creating certain sensations in my stomach, which tells me that my stomach is full.
Okay. Okay. And one needs to be careful with the words or the statement that we are telling ourselves, right?
Correct. We need to be very careful about it. So that especially is more relevant when I am giving the next example of metabolism. That when we actually talk about metabolism, a good suggestion to give yourself is that I would request my unconscious to increase the metabolism rate so that the new rate is helping me reduce this much amount of weight in this much period of time. Specify what is the period of time and what is the amount of weight. And once I've achieved that weight, my metabolism rate will readjust itself so that I can maintain that weight. Because after that, you don't want to continue losing.
Correct.
Right? So while you're creating an expectation, you're also being clear about till when the expectation is supposed to be in effect and what needs to happen after that.
Okay. Okay.
And this is important to understand, to keep in mind, because this is one of the reasons the affirmations don't work for certain people, because they've not been designed correctly.
Right. Right.
And remember the soft voice you spoke about?
Yes.
So that soft voice also needs to be addressed. So if this, if you are creating an affirmation and if you have a soft voice telling you this is not possible, then what do you do?
You modify the statement.
Correct. So you take the guidance of the soft voice, you modify the statement till the new statement does not create any negative soft voice.
Right. Correct. Makes sense. Makes sense.
Right?
Yeah.
Now, apart from this, another thing that you've seen when you work with weight is that weight generally moves in homeostasis of 5 to 7 kgs. Now, what do I mean by homeostasis? Have you noticed that when we have a weight, when we take our weight, it's generally at a particular level, right? And it maintains the level more or less. Like even if I have started dieting for a few days, I've not eaten properly for a few days, the moment I eat properly, it comes back to the original weight. Even if I go to a function or a party where I'm like really hogging for 2-3 days, in the next couple of days, it comes back to where it was originally. So it's that the is this comfort area within which the weight maintains itself most of the time.
Correct.
So this comfort area generally seems to move in chunks of 5 to 7 kg.
Okay.
What this means is when you're working with your weight, so let's say you started dieting and you started doing a lot of physical exercises to reduce your work the increased activity and reduce as in the limited diet till you have reduced your weight by 5 to 7 kgs, around 7 kgs. And after you've reduced your weight for around 7 kgs, for some time, go back to what your otherwise normal eating habits would be. So that the body starts adjusting to the new homeostasis which is being developed. You will notice that the body will pick up probably a kilo or two here and there again. But it will still shift. For example, if you started at 90, you came till 80. You went back to your normal eating habits at 83 for the next few days. You will notice the weight will stabilize at around 84, 85.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And then you do this again for the next 7 days. Wait again. Let it stabilize. So it's basically that you're giving your mind and your body time to adjust to the new homeostasis. And the shift is not so big that you go from 90 to 60 in a single go.
Okay. Okay. That's sensible, actually. Whereas I think a lot of people, when that shift, you know, that reverse shift happens. So you said that from 83, it may come back to 85. I think that's the window where a lot of people give up because it feels like, oh, you know, my effort is wasted and I'm going back. Which you are saying, actually, use that as part of the process, or that's the time your body is actually adjusting to the new level.
Correct. And for it to adjust to the new levels, go back to what your normal eating habits will be. Well, what would your ideal eating habits be after you have maintained your weight completely?
That makes sense. That makes sense. Yes, of course. Right? Of course.
Then the next thing to do is avoid using the word lose weight.
Okay.
Because when we talk about losing something, no one likes losses, right?
Oh, yes. No one likes losses.
The moment we talk about losing something, our mind then feels, oh, I need to regain it. I've lost something.
Right.
So in losing weight, maybe it's a good idea to talk about gaining health, reaching my ideal weight, right? Okay. Becoming healthier. Basically, replace the word lose weight with something which is more in sync with your understanding.
That makes sense. I think everybody, that's how they define their, objective. I want to lose 10 kgs. So that's ineffective to begin with, right?
Correct. So rather than that, say I want to reach my ideal weight, which is at this.
Correct. Makes sense. Makes sense. And what do we do if someone has no idea what to do?
So there are places where this will happen where people will say that I'm doing everything that I can. I've also started doing the white light bit. I've also started doing the chipping bit, but nothing seems to be working. It's like I'm lost for ideas now. That's the case that you can also work with the unconscious through dreams. Remember we spoke about giving a suggestion to our mind so that our mind can guide us what will be the best step or the next step forward?
Yes, yes, we did.
You can do the same thing with weight also, that at the time when I go off to sleep, I'm telling myself that I understand that I want to let go of this weight, that I want to gain health, but I seem to not be able to do it. I would request my unconscious to help me understand what will be the next step that I can take, which will give me the best result. I would actually add best and the fastest result.
Okay, okay, okay. And you also mentioned about going to the therapist. So when does that when is that needed?
So if you've tried everything above and none of them is working, or it's not working as effectively as you would like it to work, or if you realize that there's a deeper emotional issue which is connected to your eating habit, then visit the therapist is a must.
Okay. 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 And would all mental health practitioners or all therapists be able to help us with these issues?
It's difficult to say all because different mental health practitioners and therapists are trained in different ways, right? So I wouldn't be able to commit for everyone, but I can tell you that because the cognitive conduct psychotherapy process is something that we teach to people, so we know that this is already covered as a part of their training program. So they would surely be able to help you. With other therapists, you'll have to just check, speak to them and find out whether they will be able to help you and assist you with this or not.
Okay. That's great. One more thing, Nitin, I want to talk about is there's a lot of talk these days about body shaming and body positivity. And one, why is it so important? And because, you know, people say, why can't I learn to love myself rather than manage my weight? This is my body and I'm happy about it. And why do I need to manage weight? I would rather learn to love myself. So where does that come into the entire discussion?
So I actually completely agree that your weight should not define you. That's only one part of you.
Correct.
Right. And your self-worth should not actually be dependent on your weight. There are two distinct things, and you can have a really healthy self-worth irrespective of what your weight is, and you may have a very good physique and your self-worth may well still be wanting.
Correct. I think we lost Nitin there for a moment. Let's wait for him to come back. There is some network issues. I'm sure he'll be back in a moment. Nitin, are you trying to log back in? Yeah, I think he's back. We can see you, Nitin. You're back. No, that's okay. We're all facing
broken.
Yeah. So you were talking about how some people may look better yet have poor self-esteem, self-worth. So that's
correct. So now, which basically means that these two are not connected things, and they should not be equated. Yes, people should love themselves, be able to enjoy their own company irrespective of their looks, their color, their weight, and all of this. Right? Having said that, while I agree with this, this is not a good enough reason not to work towards a healthier life. Right? Because nowadays what's happening is people have started taking it to a different extent altogether. I will eat whatever comes to my mind, even if it's unhealthy for me. Why? Because I love my body the way it is. Now, if you really love your body, you will also take care of your body.
True.
Right? So while you should not be working on your weight because you feel that my weight will give me better self-worth, then you need to go and visit a therapist.
Right.
But that still doesn't mean that if you're overweight and it's reaching a place where it's going to become a health concern, that you should not be managing it or you should not be working towards reducing it.
Makes sense. Yes.
Right? It's something like, while I love the way I look, but when I go to my office, especially if I'm going for an important meeting, don't I dress in a particular way? Don't some people apply makeup? Don't some people apply gels and so on? Especially when people are coming in front of a screen, wouldn't they generally apply something on their face so that their face is more, they look more pleasing on the screen?
Yes.
Right? Now, this doesn't mean that they don't love themselves and they're doing it. It's not that people are wearing formals to go to office because they don't love themselves and they think their worth is defined by their formals.
Correct.
Right? It simply means that while they love themselves and they have a very strong self-worth, they also understand that there are certain things that can help them achieve certain outcomes. So if your weight is, while you love yourself and you may be completely comfortable with your weight, but if your weight is affecting your stamina, if it's affecting certain things that you want to do in your life, that you want to achieve in your life. And while you love yourself, you can still work on managing your weight.
Correct. Makes sense.
And as I said, in my understanding, if you really love yourself, you would want your body to be healthy. You would want to take care of it. It's not because you lack self-worth. It's because you have strong self-worth and you love yourself enough to take care of your body.
Yeah, loving yourself should include loving your body, and loving your body should include taking good care of it.
Correct.
Right. I understand what you're saying. Right. Makes sense. One more thing, Nitin. I think we are almost out of time, but one thing I must ask you. You know, a lot of parents complain that because especially during this time that children are home and parents are home, you know, children keep asking for food repeatedly. It's not related to weight management, but because we are talking about nourishment and food and, you know, how our relation with food as such. And, you know, I have observed, so this is my personal observation, that, you know, children are sitting in front of the TV and eating. In fact, a lot of parents actually make their children sit when they're very young, because a lot of children are fussy eaters and, you know, they would try to distract them with TV and shove food down their throats so that they eat. And the child, very interestingly, after probably even half an hour or so, will start asking for food. So what do you have to say about this entire thing? And then as they grow up, we are also complaining a lot about how teens are becoming overweight. You know, people are in their teens are becoming obese, and not only in India, but globally. So can you comment about that a bit?
Okay. So it's actually related to weight. See, the thing is this, that when you are eating food, your body needs to be able to understand that you're eating food. Right? Correct. There has to be this feeling of being satisfied.
Yes.
Right? And that's the place where mindful eating comes into play. That when you're eating and you're completely focusing on that food, you are chewing it properly. When you're chewing it properly, it becomes easier for your system to digest it. Your system also can taste it fully and can experience that flavor and can experience that sense of satiation completely.
Correct.
But if you're eating food while watching TV, then you're not really experiencing that sense of satisfaction because of eating, because your mind is distracted and is engaged in whatever you are eating. Sorry, whatever you're watching. Okay? And that's one of the things that happens with kids, that while parents try to distract kids by those gadgets, that's also one of the reasons why the child doesn't feel very, very satisfied. And then the parents will keep saying, after every few hours, after every few minutes, he starts crying or she starts crying and they want food again. But that's because they've not really felt the satisfaction of it, right?
Correct. And why only kids? I think this applies to us also. A lot of us are like sitting with a plate in front of Netflix.
Which is true, actually. So the idea is, that's actually a good point that you brought up, because that's something that we can add as a tip that people can follow. That when you're eating, you should actually be focusing only on eating. Don't eat while you're watching TV, while you're doing other stuff. Just focus on eating when you're eating.
Correct. Makes sense. So that will help you.
And obviously, as I said, when you're focusing on your eating, you're also chewing your food properly. So also chew your food properly. But these are like really really commonsensical things to do.
But while they are commonsensical, then we often forget about, you know, even commonsensical things. So yes, that definitely makes sense. And Nitin, now that we've spoken about weight and food, and aren't we, so on the other side, on the other end of the spectrum, aren't we also sometimes addicted to certain types of food or the idea of food itself?
We are, but addiction by itself is a different topic altogether. In fact, with reference to food, when we spoke about compulsive eating, emotional eating, they are kind of examples of addiction, right? Food. They may not be so drastic, but they still are examples of addictions. In fact, I had a client sometime back who actually had a similar problem that he worked with. But addiction by itself is a different problem. Maybe because tomorrow's episode is about addiction, we will talk more about addictions tomorrow in detail, both with respect to food and with other addictions. And one of the interesting addictions that we are going to talk about is love, which very few people really realize can also be an addiction.
Oh, that's interesting. Perfect. Then I think we are done with our today's episode. There's a lot of, what should I say, profound understanding, commonsensical yet very profound understandings and insights there. A lot of techniques that we can apply, and if you still can't see a result, then of course you can always visit a therapist. And as Nitin said, cognitive hypnotic psychotherapists are well equipped to work with mental state, deep-rooted emotions, and anything else related to any, not only food or weight management, but other problems as well. And if you want to talk to a therapist, find a therapist, a cognitive nordic psychotherapist specifically, you can visit www.ichars.com. You can either write a mail to them, or you'll find a number that you can call, and they'll, I think, help you get in touch with a therapist, right, Nitin?
Correct. And they can actually help you get in touch with a therapist, whoever would be nearest you. A lot of things nowadays are also moving online. So probably you'll also be able to connect with someone if you don't have anyone physically close to you, right, where you're living. Then probably someone may also be able to work with you via Zoom calls or Skype calls and so on.
Perfect. So that sums it up. And of course, tomorrow we are going to talk about addictions. And Nitin has already got us intrigued by telling us that we are also going to talk about something called love addiction. I was only thinking smoking and drinking and drugs and stuff. But this seems to be more interesting than that.
Yeah, so we'll because see you... those are things that everyone can understand as addictions. With respect to Correct. Love, meditations, it's very difficult for people to even put them in the category of addictions, while they are. Many a time.
Correct. So tomorrow is about that. But before we sign off, I would like to share once again that ICHAR Support Foundation is running a series of initiatives during this time and otherwise, which you can look up on www.ichars.foundation. These are all non-profit initiatives to help people. There is an on-call helpline. You can talk to mental health practitioners and ask for help to resolve your issues, any kind of issues, especially anxiety during these times. And talking of anxiety, there is an online video support group to help you cope with COVID-related anxiety. There is another wonderful initiative, which is again online support group for LGBTQ community. So you're most welcome to look it up and join if you want to, or spread a word amongst your friends. So there is when you click on those links on the web page, you'll be directed to the groups, and then you can share the groups in your posts or in your WhatsApp groups as you see fit. Thank you so much, Nitin, for today.
Thank you, Mamta, for hosting me today.
And thank you everyone who joined in. If there are any questions we have not been able to answer, we'll surely answer them after the show. And we'll also take up any unanswered questions from all the episodes in the end. Right, Nitin?
We would take up all the unanswered questions. Yes.
Perfect then. Thank you so much for today. And have a good night. We'll see you tomorrow, FB Live, 5:30 p.m. on another episode of True Talks.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.